Yeah, welcome back to The Breakfast on PLOS TV Africa. The conversation is about the 2023 presidential zoning and has been calls from several quarters to zone the presidency for 2023 to the south. But still, many leaders, especially Northern Nigeria, disagree, and they say that they have strength in numbers and, of course, would go ahead to push for a Northern candidate come 2023. Let's invite our guest now, Mr. Ibrahim Oshinowo. Good morning. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning. Good morning, viewers. Good morning, Nigerians.
Morning.
Okay. I want us to first get your weigh in on this subject matter regarding zoning to the south or to the north. In the south, they're saying that leaders, especially Governor Rotimi Akeredolu, has said that the next president of Nigeria should come from the south, and that it should follow the rotational system because of the principle of justice and fairness. But on the other hand, northern leaders are saying that we should not neglect competence for justice and fairness, and that there are also competent leaders amongst northerners. Where do you come in?
Anyway, I will start by, you know, going into the background of, you know, new northern elites and the young ones who are probably my age, just like my friend, the Arewa Consultative Forum, what's his name? Shetima. You know, he raised this issue, you know, back in probably in December in Abuja, where we were at the conference. And personally, I told him that, look, the major issue in this country, it's not about you being a party A, party B, or party C. It's about fairness, equity, and justice. The northern elites who are clamoring for northern presidency again are so vicious in their thoughts, because most of the challenges of security that we are having in this country, even right from the Boko Haram, the Mahzab, and the rest of them, are foundationed on fairness, equity, and justice. There is no justice, and any society where you don't have fairness, equity, and justice, what you will see is a security breach, you know, emancipation of people from one point to the other, insurrection, and the rest of it. And we need to look inward. I expect the National Security Advisor to come in and advise at this point in time. You remember during President Jonathan, His Excellency, the National, during the election, you know, changing postponement at the end of, the National Security Advisor advised in a crucial, and I'm also in a crucial time, and I'm also calling on the National Assembly to wade in into this, you know, shallow discussion, because I'm sure by December, by grace of God, or by early next year, this, the northern agenda is going to pop up. And when it pops up, it's going to hit our politics like never before. Now, their calculation is President Obasanjo, His Excellency, has served for 8 years from the south. President Umaru Musa Yar'Adua has served for 2 years. Then the southern president, President Goodluck Jonathan, has taken off for another 6 years. That is 8 plus 6. That's 14 years. Then, inshallah, by grace of God, President Buhari will finish his 8-year tenure, married to the plus two, married to the two from President Umaru Yar'Adua. That will be 10 years, and they still have the leftover of 4 years. The issue that warranted the lapses and taking over from the south was just natural, that nobody has control of. The southern does not force themselves into power. The nature takes its course. And I told him, I remember I told some of my northern friends that, look, the military has ruled this country more than any other tribe. And most of the northern, most of the military leaders are from the north. From General Yakubu Gowon, President Obasanjo took over just later as 1979, just less than 2 or 3 years, handed over to a civilian. President Buhari came, General Buhari came in. From there, Babangida. From there, General Abacha. From there, we have General Abdusalam, and so many others. Now, if we are calculating that at this point in time, where we have division across the country, people are clamoring for secession, people are making this. We need to pacify the agitators. We need to be honest and be nationalistic. The going back to the North agenda they are clamoring for, I believe it won't see the light of the day. And I hope some of the Northern elites will rethink and believe that, okay, we have done 8 years. Let the South, you know, come in. I give kudos to the Southern governor. Like never before, the Southern governor under the leadership of His Excellency Governor Akeredolu and Governor Kwade Fayemi has been doing wonderfully well. And I give it to the PDP governors in the South as well. They ditch the party affiliation and become a patriotic governor who sees that the coexistence of this country is so germane and paramount to them. So I will advise those who are clamoring for the Northern governor, the Northern presidency, to please rethink and be, you know, and fight for the unity of this country. The PDP, we understand what they are doing. I can tell you for free that their national chairman will come from the South, thinking that they can bank on the strength of the North with numbers and move the presidency back to the North. We can't speak for them. Time will tell. Yes.
Yeah, so that's, you know, an angle that I wanted to, you know, get you to speak on. The PDP's decision, of course, they're going to be very careful, you know, with regards who they eventually pick, and also be watchful as to whoever the APC also puts forward to look at their chances. But there is also that narrative, when you mentioned just now that they will pick their chairman from the South and then pick their presidential candidate from the North, there's that narrative that, you know, the North basically includes the Middle Belt, includes also the southern parts of different northern states, which seems to be a little unfair, because, of course, the Middle Belt have every now and then always tried to point out that they don't necessarily belong and they should not just be grouped along with Northern Nigeria. So I want you to speak with regards to that. And then also, there are certain promises that were made, if you remember, in 2015 and I believe in 2019, to the Southeast, seeking their support. And of course, making those promises that they would be, you know, allowed to, you know, win presidency. Doesn't it feel, you know, sad for, you know, the Southeast now that they don't even seem to be being brought into the conversation?
Look, the Southeasterners, of course, they have one of the best. Even some of my, you know, professional mentor who are in the South, like Professor Charles Soludo, Professor Mogolu, the rest of them, they are one of the Southeasterners, one of the fantastic and, you know, decent guys in terms of policy, economy, in terms of governance, infrastructure, in terms of, you know, growing the tech industry. I give it to the Southeast. They are one of the pillars of this country, and they have the right to the presidency. But unfortunately, politics is a game of number. It's a game of negotiation. I don't sit in my house and expect somebody to bring the ticket of Senate or vote me into a National Assembly. It's not going to happen. I have to go out there and push for it, negotiate, discuss, and make sure things happen. You know, so the Southeasterners need to negotiate. You know, I can't remember the name of the present Indigo Association. I forgot the
Professor John Obiozo.
Yes, the old man is a fantastic man. He said Indigo has one of the best brain, and they are ready to negotiate. If the both leading party sewage their ticket, presidential ticket into the South, Indigo has one of the brightest chance. There are some personally, if my party nominates certain names from Igboland, I will be at the front of the national campaign. You know, yes, they believe that, you know, the North will not, you know, trust them with power, you know, even some section of the South believe that as well. But they have to come out and campaign. What Governor Obi said on the Arise TV yesterday also is to let them understand that they have the best brain, but they are ready to come out and channel their campaign into allowing other tribes and other regions to see the quality they have. So they have to negotiate. They are not going to bring the presidency into their region on Salakat. They have to come out, they have to be strategic, they have to campaign even to the North, to the other region, northeast, northwest, southwest, south, to let them see reason why they can leave the country and why they can assure others that there is not going to be breakup of this country. Because the issue they are having is that people believe that if they have the power, the country will disintegrate. And that we can actually, you know, project for them or assure them. They have to campaign. Like in the Southwest, where I come from, we have one of the best men. We have some of our leaders who are showing their interests, both direct and indirectly. And you see the emancipation of people popping into APC, you know, believing that that's the vehicle we are, that can lead this country based on what they are doing right now. PDP also believes that they have some of the smartest guys in the North, and they are zoning their vice presidential candidate back to the Southeast. Some of them who are my friends believe that they are soaring to the Southeast is the best as a vice president. In fact, under Governor Fintiri right now, they have the structural, you know, how their government is going to look like. And I'm sure in the South, Southeast is going to take the chunk of their government position, eventually, if they eventually, which I doubt, I am not sure they can even, you know, come into that. If they eventually form the government, which I'm sure they cannot, obviously, most of the allotment of their position will go to the Southeast to just to pacify and let them feel the inclusiveness. But however, they have to come out and campaign. The South, we have quality governors like Governor Wike, you know, Governor of Ebonyi State. We have the Governor of Anambra State, Willobi Ano, who have done a pretty well for me. And we have some quality governors in the Southwest. Governor Dapo Abiodun, who is doing well, also Governor Sanwo-Olu, doing well. And among Governor Fayemi, a qualified second-time governor, who is doing fantastically and leading the governors as well. So we have quality people in the staff. So they have to come out and market their product. I'm not going to do that for them. So they must come out.
Oshinowo,
so that's what I think about that.
You have been talking about the issue of, you know, secessionist agitations. And the way it's seeming like, you know, as though a presidential ticket is going to be a way to appease people who want to break out of Nigeria, would that not be just avoiding the issue? Why don't we find a way to fix the root cause of why these people are agitating, rather than just hand over a presidential ticket? What if the person isn't competent enough for leadership and they just give them the presidency simply because you want to appease these people who are agitating to break out of the country? Because bear in mind, the fact that they want a southern presidency, that's not the only reason why these people are agitating. They're agitating for all-round inclusiveness and not just the presidency.
Look, my dear sister, there's no way we can hand over. I'm not saying we're going to hand over the ticket to the Southeast. Agitation or no agitation is not coming from the Southeast alone. It's coming from the Southwest. It's coming from the Middle Belt. It's coming from every part of the country. So it's not about handing over. Nobody will hand over the ticket to them. There's better way of many ways of pacifying them, you know, feeling, making them feel inclusive in what everybody is doing. And they are doing it. You can imagine they have Minister for Labor. They have Minister for Environment right now, Sharon Ikeazo. They have so many, you know, ministers in the Jewish. The head of budget is one of them. You know, they are one of the best brains in the government. And, you know, there's better ways that the party can do better, probably giving them one of the top most, you know, kitchen cabinet appointment. But they have to market as well. Nobody will give them all these positions, you know, because they are agitating. I can agitate from the Southwest. Sunday Bo is agitating from my own region, believing that people have been killed unjustly. So everybody can agitate. I can decide tomorrow that I want to be an agitator. It's my choice. And because I'm agitating does not mean that they have to bring the presidency or they have to bring the, let's say, a chief of staff to the president or a secretary to the federation to Southwest. So it doesn't work like that. They have to market themselves. They have to discuss with other tribes. And Indigo is doing very, very well in terms. The new leadership is doing fantastically well, you know, negotiating. And you can imagine what they are doing in the Southeast, you know, disrupting young folks who are writing WAEC, damaging their small-scale businesses, shutting down their business. Most of the banks are not working there. They are not affecting Southwest. They are killing their economy. These are the things I see that the young folks around there can do better. They can come to the table and negotiate. Even in the Kano can come to the table and negotiate. Okay, these are my grievances. These are the things. These are the reasons why I want to move. And I encourage the federal government as well to allow them to come to the table. You can sit on the COVID table and negotiate. These are the things I don't want. These are the things I think is right. These are the things I think we want more in the government.
All right. Ms. Oshino, kindly hold on. Yeah, kindly hold on. Because of, you know, we have just a few minutes left. I want you to, you mentioned earlier, politics is a game of numbers. And that will determine very greatly what the position the PDP will take if it wants, you know, to have a strong chance of winning. But can you share with us, you know, what direction you think the APC would also take if it really wants to stand a chance of winning again in 2023? Seeing the little details here and there as to where the people would likely want to, you know, vote. I've heard people say whoever it is that brings forth a southern candidate is who I'm going to vote for, regardless of the party. So, you know, what position do you think the APC would like to take?
Yes, unfortunately, I may not be able to speak for the party. I'm not responsible, but I'm a member of the party, so I can speak on my personal, you know, renderings. Now, the party, our party has done greatly well in the north, you know, in terms of infrastructure development and tackling the security. You know, don't forget that we met the security challenge in place. We met the IDP's camp in place. We met a lot of things in place, and we are doing well to, you know, to subvert the pressure. And we are negotiating, putting more investment in that angle. Now, if the party decides that the presidency is going to be zoned to the west, a lot of people to the south, a lot of people is going to vote for us from the north. Don't forget that if we slot zone the participants to the south, of course the vice president is going to come from the north and other, you know, positions. So if the party decides, whatever the party decides, I'm fine with it, and I can assure you the northern will vote for APC. Is a tag on your chest. It's hard for you to remove it. So, you know, everybody is going to vote for APC, even in the north. So we are waiting. And, you know, we're just giving them a few months to round up their convention. And we will swing into action and make sure that, you know, the party performs credibly well. Most of our governors are doing well. Name them. People are joining into our party. Recently, you can see some of the strong PDP stewards, I don't want to mention them, I don't want to promote anybody, who are trooping in. They could see the light now, as they rightly said, most of them. And I will be expecting some of them, like Dino, to... distinguished senator, most of them are still coming to join APC. So many governors from the southeast also are still coming to join APC. So you can see in my own state, you can see what we're doing in Lagos, in Ogun, you know, credibly with a good infrastructural development, good economic policy, and the rest of them. So we hope anywhere we zone our presidential candidate, we're going to have a quality presidential candidate, quality one, that will deliver the goods for ordinary Nigerians, that will subvert the agitation of people, including the southeast, discuss with them. So we are set for it. I can assure you we'll form the next government again.
Ms. Oshinowa, are you saying that Dino Melaye is coming to the party?
Yeah, you know, Dino, I've known Dino during our school days as a NAS member. Dino is a very fantastic, you know, legislator. He's a vibrant and dogged gentleman. He will see the light again. He used to say it that before he was blind, and now he's, you know, he could see the light.
All right, Mr. Oshinowo, we'll be waiting for the official announcement. Thank you very much.
No, don't. You know, we discussed about one gentleman that just joined recently. We told you several on this studio that is coming.
Thank you, Mr. Oshinowo. And that's all for now. Thank you very much. Thanks for coming. Thanks. Have a great day. All right, that's it there on The Breakfast this morning. Really talked about the fundamental difference between Boko Haram, ISWAP, and banditry, and the conversation about the 2023 presidential elections and zoning. Thanks again for watching. Catch up on any part of the conversation you missed out on by following us on all social media platforms at Plus TV Africa. I am Aneta Felix.
And I am Osaogie Ogbonwa.
Bye for now.